off the air for a brief time around 9:30 this morning, about half an hour from now. Sorry, BBC. We shouldn't be down too long, though. Our engineers do like to work fast when they're at the tower, so during the brief outage this morning at 9:30, you can listen to us online at WUSF.org or on our smartphone app from WUSF.org/mobile. So again, a program note, we will be off the air briefly, at around 9:30 this morning. Support for WUSF comes from Utica College, now offering an accelerated second bachelor's degree in nursing in St. Petersburg, where you can earn a degree in as little as 16 months. More information is at acceleratednursing.utica.edu. South Florida Museum presents Coffee, the World in Your Cup, last day today. This exhibit features the story of one of the world's most widely traded commodities and how it has affected cultures, economies, and environments across the globe. Information at southfloridamuseum.org. Support for NPR comes from the Ford Foundation, working with visionaries on the front lines of social change worldwide at fordfoundation.org. Doris Duke Charitable Foundation, supporting the performing arts, the environment, medical research, and child well-being. And the Kresge Foundation, expanding opportunities in America's cities at kresge.org. A 60% chance for showers or thunderstorms today with a high of 92. Clearing overnight, a low of 78. And a 40% chance for showers or storms tomorrow, Sunday, and Labor Day Monday. This is WUSF 89.7 Tampa, St. Petersburg, Sarasota. News and information with All Night Jazz. It's 9 o'clock.
BBC World Service. This is Owen Bennett Jones. Wind News Hour. And coming up in the next 60 minutes, the Ukrainian Prime Minister says he'd like NATO membership. The NATO Secretary General was asked for his reaction.
We adhere to the principle that each and every nation has the right to decide itself without interference from outside.
We hear the latest on the Ebola outbreak from Ivory Coast border with Guinea.
I'm afraid of death because it's not a trip that you can return from. We've been told not to be bushmeat, not to shake hands, and not to have sex.
And the Syrian disaster has led to millions of lives totally being disrupted. We speak to the UN Refugee Agency about the scale of the problem.
Washington, I'm Janine Herbst. NATO's Deputy Secretary General Alexander Virchow says Russia has moved around 1,000 troops and tanks into eastern Ukraine, apparently making a land corridor to Crimea.
Right now, Russia has to supply Crimea by sea or by air. Moreover, the port of Mariupol is a key seaport for Ukraine and for its grain exports. The Ukrainian ambassador just highlighted the serious implications if the Russians were to move that far.
But Russia vehemently denies it's directly aiding pro-Russian separatists. The government says any Russians who may be in Ukraine are volunteers. Fyodor Lupianov is the editor-in-chief of Russia in Global Affairs. He says he's not sure if Russian troops are on the ground.
As long as the negotiations continue, both sides, I mean, supported by Russia and Kyiv supported by the West, both sides
has become the biggest humanitarian emergency of our era. many Americans are saving is on the rise. Government says savings increased to $739 billion last month. That's the highest level since December of 2012. U.S. futures contracts are trading higher just about 20 minutes before the opening bell. Dow futures contract up 0.1%. NASDAQ futures contract is up 0.2%. And European markets are also trading higher this morning. FTSE in London up 0.2%. This is in the support for the
Judd said he would enforce the law either way, but that the amendment contains multiple loopholes that would bring about unintended consequences, such as making pot more available to young teens.
I am your servant, but it's my job as your sheriff to say, beware of the consequences.
The constitutional amendment will be on the November 4th ballot. Robin Sussingham, WUSF 89.7 News.
Julie Marquez of Bay News 9 says a 60% chance for showers or storms today. It's 9:06.
You're listening to the BBC World Service. This is Owen Bennett-Jones with News Hour. Coming up on the programme, the scandal at the heart of a British TV show. A baking contest. We'll hear from a former winner.
I just remember being in that penthouse here that there isn't a lot of fridge space, there isn't a lot of space to be putting things down, there's not a lot of time with the commotion, the cameras.
All will become clear on that story later, but we begin in Ukraine, and the Prime Minister there says he wants to move towards NATO membership. The NATO Secretary General, Anders von Rasmussen, was asked in a news conference a few hours ago for his reaction.
Ukraine has decided to pursue a so-called non-alliance policy. We fully respect that. We fully respect if the Ukrainian parliament decides to change that policy, because we adhere to the principle that each and every nation has the right to decide itself without interference from outside. And we hope that other nations adhere to the same principle.
And he added that NATO had, in fact, previously banned Ukrainian membership of the organisation.
I'm not going to interfere with political discussions in Ukraine, but let me remind you of NATO's decision taken at the Bucharest summit in 2008, according to which Ukraine will become a member of NATO, provided, of course, that Ukraine so wishes and provided that Ukraine fulfill the necessary criteria.
It's been quite an interesting line coming out of NATO, suggesting maybe Ukrainian membership is possible. I know across monitors Chris Morris, he was watching the speech.
Yeah, you know, he didn't quite tell us the whole story of what happened back at that summit in 2008. What went on there was that the United States, which was then, of course, the Bush administration, pushed pretty hard for countries like Ukraine and Georgia to have a guaranteed path towards NATO membership, a very clear path, and other countries objected. France and Germany, notably, the alliance was split about it, and the compromise was a fairly vaguely worded promise that if they so desired, there could sometime in the future be membership. The membership was not ruled out. threatened to go to war with Russia, because that's essentially what we're talking about here, in order to defend territory in eastern Ukraine. So there are a host of hurdles. I mean, there are also things which Ukraine would need to do in terms of reform, political reform, reform of its military and so on. But I think there is deep-seated reluctance in parts of the alliance still. While they will certainly come out, and we'll obviously see their summit next week, they will come out with ringing declarations of political support. There may be measures to say we will push for further training of the Ukrainian military, more financial aid perhaps. But the idea of bringing Ukraine into NATO, something which Vladimir Putin has for years made clear he is vehemently opposed to, is something which still causes deep disquiet in several alliance capitals.
Chris Morris there with NATO's take and the thinking behind the various NATO capitals on this issue. Let's get an idea now of the thinking in Moscow. And first of all, just some news from the streets in Moscow about these events in Ukraine.
Associate with a war.
And when you look at the TV channels in Moscow and other big Russian cities, what sort of line are they taking on what's happening in Ukraine?
The TV is very interesting because TV is so powerful here. You know, 90% of the population in Russia gets its information from the television. So, for example, I watched Russian TV's morning news show this morning, and there was absolutely no mention of the criticism that President Obama had made of Moscow. No mention at all about Western claims of a Russian military incursion in eastern Ukraine. And so the majority of the Russian population are unaware of such criticisms. Instead, the kind of line you hear in the State of Bulletins is criticism of the United States, accusations that the United States and NATO are trying to meddle in Russia's internal affairs, and also expressing time and time again.
School's on, I didn't see that, I didn't expect that.
Is the humanitarian situation in eastern Ukraine, and there's a lot of mention about how important this is to President Putin.
And just before you go, one thought on this idea that the Prime Minister in Ukraine is asking the Parliament to process an application for NATO membership. You know, is there any reaction in Moscow to that?
No reaction so far, but that, of course, is going to anger politicians here. I remember a senior Russian MP told me a couple of months ago that Russia didn't mind if sometime down the road Ukraine became a member of the European Union, but it was complete red line for Moscow that Ukraine must not become a member of NATO, because if that happens, Russia would see that as a major threat to its national security.
Steve Rosenberg there. Well, we're going to take a closer look at the consistent Russian claims that all this that's going on in Kiev is somehow fascistic. Is a theme that President Putin himself picked up today in a speech to students in Western Russia.
Occupiers surrounded our cities, in particular Leningrad, and directly shot the cities and their residents.
This is all part of the Russian narrative, so what's behind it? A question I put to Alex Pravda of Oxford University.
Well, basically, it's an attempt to invoke the most powerful symbol which resonates with all Russians, actually, whether liberal or conservative, the Russian victory in World War II over the odds, and operating at their best under huge pressure in Leningrad, and the siege of Leningrad, and all the casualties endured there, appeal to everybody. So at a time where there's a lot of division of opinion in Russia, as you've just heard on the street there from your interviews, about military interventionism from Moscow into Ukraine, into a country which is populated by fraternal Slavs, as it were, no one's at war with it. The one thing you can do is to say the country, our country, is in danger because there is a Kiev fascist Nazi threat. But it's interesting, that was emphasized, it keeps being emphasized by Putin. It was emphasized very early on, it had a big effect. The public opinion poll showed that many people thought there were fascists in Kiev. There was a coup. That's gone down now. The latest poll showed that maybe something like 6% of people believe that there's been a coup in Kiev. Poroshenko, the president, is now accepted as someone who is actually elected legitimately. So that sort of narrative that is all fascist is giving way among the population to a narrative that is civil war, and that a lot of these fascistic elements are now terrorists fighting against Russians and Russian interests. But there's still no majority support for military intervention. Only about 1 in 10, even if NATO were involved in Donbass, the eastern regions of Ukraine, only about 1 in 10 Russians say they would support a military response from Moscow under those circumstances.
But going back to the Second World War, what happened in Ukraine? There was the Soviet Union, and then there were pro-German elements fighting there?
Well, of course. I mean, a lot of the West Ukrainian nationalists do admire the sort of resistance to the Soviet Union in the Second World War under sort of Bandera, sort of nationalist leader, and the Banderists have been denounced by Russia as pro-German, pro-Nazi, anti-Soviet collaborators and so on. So there's this labelling of the extremists in Kiev, the Western Ukrainian nationalists, the anti-Russian element by Moscow, when they want to get some sort of nationalist support of an emotional kind for what's happening in Ukraine and in the East.
Right, and is there any sort of justification in this sense? Is there a continuous line of the leading from those Western Ukrainian nationalists in the Second World War through to the current politicians in Kiev?
Well, look, I mean, the current political scene in Kiev is extremely fragmented and extremely confused. There are certainly elements of Western Ukrainian nationalists who were in the lead when the Soviet Union broke up, who now are in the right sector parties, the parties which are critical of the lack of Ukrainian armed force response to the situation in the East. There have been lots of arguments among the people in Kiev, and the right sector still plays a role. And the National Guard is much more right-wing inclined than the government itself. So, of course, there are elements, there are grains of truth in this, but the image is blown up for obvious propaganda reasons on the Russian side to gather national mobilization of national feeling and patriotism behind the policy.
Sure, and the true inheritors of that sort of any pro-Nazi feeling would be very right-wing, extreme right-wing groups now, which are quite small, I'm thinking.
They are quite small, yeah. But the problem is at the moment we're in a pre-election period. You know, the president has dissolved parliament, is going to dissolve, and we're going to have elections in October. So running up to that, one would expect the right to do rather well, and that'll be more pressure on Poroshenko.
And giving us the benefit of his historical knowledge there, that was Alex Pravda from St. Anthony's College, Oxford University. You're listening to me.
This week on Foreign Matters,
32% of our sex trafficking victims are trafficked by someone that they know.
Human trafficking is a growing problem worldwide, and Florida has been a hub for the activity with one of the highest rates in the country.
When I learned that of the calls to the National Human Trafficking Hotline, Florida rate
Alpha. And Professor of Earth Science at the University of Cambridge, Simon Redfern, explained what happened.
It's a fissure eruption that is emanating from a crack in the ground that's about a kilometre long, and it's quite a gentle, it's called an effusive eruption, so it's not explosive. It's, at the moment, simply a lava flow and a little bit of ash fire, as it were, that's been seen, and what's most obvious from it is the white steam.
Well, science reporter Rebecca Morell came in earlier. I asked if effusive eruptions tend to become explosive ones.
Maybe. They're quite unpredictable volcanoes, and we've actually just heard, and it's keeping us on our feet, that the aviation has been downgraded to orange now. And that's because there's not so much ash there, as we've just heard. It's made of lava, lots of white steam coming out of this large 1 kilometre long crack on the ground. But that's starting to subside a little bit as well. So scientists are basically sat there watching to see what's going to happen, because you've got a few scenarios. There was a volcano which looked quite similar to this one back in the 70s, where it erupted along a fissure, this long crack along the ground. And for 10 years, that basically produced spectacular fire fountains, which sound a bit scary, but they're really beautiful, and actually they don't really cause many problems. And there is a chance that if the eruption does keep on going along this fissure, we will get a similar scenario. There's a scarier scenario, though, and that's if the magma heads for another volcano called Askja, which is really, really big. And if the magma from Bardufoss connects up with the magma from Askja, then you could have potentially a bigger eruption.
You
going
to go there?
Maybe. Hopefully. I'd love to go, actually, but it depends what happens.
Africa.
Supporting your local team. Get out there and see our Rays beat Boston. We're playing them tonight at 7 o'clock. Again, tomorrow night at 7 o'clock. And then Sunday afternoon after 1 o'clock. So get out there and support our Rays while they beat Boston. 3 games this week.
Thank you. speaking. It's absolutely crucial for their communication.
You're familiar with what's out there. If you were dictator for a day, would you ban it?
I would not, and I'll tell you why. In order for you to understand how these groups function, you need to look at what they're doing. Though the darknet is almost, it's very difficult to scrutinize and track, intelligence agencies are still capable of infiltrating them. Plus, when you close these platforms down, more platforms will pop up. And ultimately, they take the database they have and upload it on a different domain and put a new URL and have another website. Even if you keep closing them, it's almost like a whack-a-mole game. You close one down, a couple more come back up. It's almost like a failed strategy to try to close them down. But it's a much better strategy to keep a close eye on them.
And that was late Al-Khoury. Yesterday, Malaysia Airlines' terrible financial figures came out, and as everyone expected, given the two disasters, the plane that went missing over the Indian Ocean and the one shot down over Ukraine, basically people stopped using the airline in large numbers. And so now the airline has come up with a business response, if you like. They've got a plan. What is it? Our Asia correspondent is John Sudworth.
The most significant part of it is the announcement that they're going to cut 6,000 workers, almost a third of the total workforce. And for staff who already, you have to think, have been facing a pretty torrid time, some of them will, of course, have lost close colleagues and friends on board those two aircraft earlier this year, now facing the very real prospect of having to lose their jobs. But in addition to the job cuts, talk of looking for a new CEO, which should be in place sometime next year, and talk also about spending a total sum of money, close to $2 billion, to try to turn what was already a struggling airline and is now, you know, you have to admit, an airline in real, real difficulty, to try to turn it around.
Yeah, well, so what was the problem before these two air disasters? What was going wrong then?
It was a bloated and inefficient carrier facing stiff competition from budget airlines, you know, as a lot of the established flag carriers are in many other regions of the world. But even compared to some of its closer rivals of similar size,
Katrina.
Now charter schools have been folded into a new recipe for public education there.
It's been Gumbo City for a reason. Whether you want to call it an experiment, we have to give it a fair opportunity to see if this can work.
Checking in on the New Orleans experiment today on All Things Considered from NPR News. Tune in for All Things Considered coming your way this afternoon.